Bandwidth is one of the key banner specifications of oscilloscope probes. Understanding just a few concepts can keep you from making common mistakes that can cause inaccurate measurements and errors. Hi everyone, I'm Erin, and welcome to the new series, Probing Pitfalls. In this series, you'll learn all about common probing pitfalls and how to avoid them. This will give you the confidence that the signal you see on the scope screen is the best representation of what's coming out of your device under test, or your DUT. In this episode, you'll learn about critical bandwidth pitfalls, like not knowing about the 3 dB point, forgetting to consider bandwidth with respect to rise time, not understanding harmonics, or not calculating the entire system bandwidth. Many engineers believe using a 100 MHz probe to analyze a 100 MHz signal is the perfect setup, but there are a few things they don't realize. The first is the 3 dB point. The easiest way to understand probe bandwidth is by learning this theory. The bandwidth is defined by the point at which the frequency components passing through the probe are attenuated or decreased by 3 dB. In other words, the amplitude of your signal is reduced by 70.7% of what it should be. As an example, let's say we're working with a 20 MHz probe. To start out, I'm measuring a 1 MHz signal with 1 volt peak to peak that's coming from my waveform generator. The peak to peak measurement you see on screen is accurate at 1 volt peak to peak, because we're using a probe that has plenty of bandwidth for the signal. However, if I increase the frequency of the signal to 20 MHz, you can see we hit the 3 dB point of the probe, which means we'll see a measurement error of minus 3 dB or minus 0.3 volts peak to peak. You can see in our peak to peak measurement here, our 1 volt peak to peak is now reading off at 0.7 volts peak to peak. You can fix this pitfall by calculating the correct bandwidth for your desired frequency. A common rule of thumb is your probe bandwidth should be at least 3 times the size of the sine wave you wish to measure. As a result, to measure this 20 MHz sine wave, we would want a probe with at least 60 MHz. Now remember, this only works for perfect sine waves, but most analog measurements aren't perfect sine waves. If this is the case, the rise time theory is critical in determining the necessary probe bandwidth. To truly calculate the best probe bandwidth needed, you need to know the rise time of your signal. The rise time is the time it takes for your signal to get from the 10% level to the 90% level of a rising edge. This formula states that the bandwidth of a signal equals 0.34 divided by the rise time for a signal with Gaussian response. And again, this is when evaluating rising edges from 10% to 90%. Many times the rise time specification is listed along with the other banner specs of your design. As an example, think about a clocked signal with a frequency of 500 MHz. Well, you may think, all right, I just need a 1.5 GHz probe to measure that signal according to what Erin said a minute ago. But your rise time could change everything. If your rise time for the 500 MHz clock signal is something like 350 picoseconds, the calculated bandwidth of that signal based on the formula is actually equal to 1 GHz. This means that the real bandwidth of your signal is 1 GHz, not 500 MHz. 500 MHz is your clock frequency for an entire cycle, but your clock's rising edge is much faster at 1 GHz. This would mean that you would actually need a 3 GHz probe to measure that signal accurately. Avoid the pitfall of not having enough bandwidth by remembering to check your rise time specification. Another way to visualize the effects of bandwidth is by looking at the different harmonics of a signal. The yellow trace here shows the original signal and is made from the fundamental harmonics. The first harmonic can be seen as this green trace. You can see it has the same period and duty cycle as the original signal, but the rising edges are slower and the corners are more rounded. The first and third harmonic are combined in the purple signal and have a faster rising edge and the corners are even more crisp. But the first, third, and fifth harmonic are combined in the pink trace and have faster edges, crisper corners, and even more detail on the top and the bottom of the waveform. The higher the probe bandwidth, the more detailed your waveform is going to become because the more harmonics can be captured. Now let's take a look at this harmonic knowledge a little bit further by looking at a 20 MHz clock wave. Here you can see the result of measuring a 20 MHz clock with a 20 MHz probe. Basically, we can't capture enough of the harmonics of the 20 MHz signal because we don't have enough probe bandwidth, and the result is going to look like a sine wave. any measurements made on that signal will be inaccurate. If we measure the same signal using a 200 megahertz probe, the result is a clean square wave that you can see here because the critical harmonics of the 20 megahertz signal are able to be captured in the measurement. The last common pitfall when it comes to bandwidth is when engineers forget about the system bandwidth. Your probe combined with your scope creates the system. And the bandwidth of this whole system is lower than you may think. Let's say both your oscilloscope and your probe bandwidths are 500 megahertz. Using this formula, the system bandwidth would be 353 megahertz. So you can see that the system bandwidth is degraded greatly from the two individual bandwidth specifications of the probe and the scope. And this will just keep getting worse if you start using accessories, but I'll save that for a later episode. Obviously, system bandwidth is another important aspect to consider when you're selecting the correct probe bandwidth. Now that you understand these common pitfalls, you can understand why choosing a probe with adequate bandwidth is crucial for making accurate measurements. Having too little bandwidth means that you won't be able to see a true representation of your signal, making it difficult for you to make good engineering decisions while designing. To learn more about probing, click on the link on screen and subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And for anyone wondering about my cast, this is what happens when you steal probes.